by Shania Twain. And it says, "From this moment, I have been blessed. I live only for your happiness, and for your love, I give my last breath from this moment on. I give my hand to you with all my heart. Can't wait to live my life with you. Can't wait to start. You and I will never be apart. My dreams came true because of you from this moment on." Helen Clinton, this is your moment. We're going to sing the first hymn, which is "How You Washed in the Middle of the Light." Okay, let's try it. Conclude that it must not be regarded in a light manner but must be undertaken and entered into in all solemnity, with wisdom and forethought, reverently and in the fear of God. Into this holy bond these two persons here present are now to be joined. Therefore, if any person can show any just cause why they may not lawfully be joined together, let him now speak, or else hereafter forever hold his peace. That's the difficult bit, all of it. I require and charge you both, as you will answer at the day of judgment, when the secrets of all hearts are made known, that if either of you knows of any lawful impediment why you may not be joined in marriage, you confess it now. Clinton, will you repeat after me, please? I do solemnly declare,
I do solemnly declare,
that I know not,
that I know not,
of any lawful impediment,
any lawful impediment,
why I, Clinton Hutchinson,
why I, Clinton Hutchinson,
may not be joined in matrimony,
may not be joined in matrimony,
to Helen Louise Ward.
To Helen Louise Ward.
Helen, I will be touching, please. I do solemnly declare,
I do solemnly declare,
that I know not,
that I know not,
of any lawful impediment,
of any lawful impediment,
why I, Helen Louise Ward,
why I, Helen Louise Ward,
may not be joined in matrimony,
may not be joined in matrimony,
to Clinton Hutchinson.
To Clinton Hutchinson.
Clinton Hutchinson, will you take Helen Louise Ward as your wife to live together in marriage according to God's laws? Will you love her, comfort her, honour and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all of them? Keep only unto her as long as you both shall live. Helen Louise Ward, will you take Clinton Hutchinson as your husband to live together in marriage according to God's laws? Will you love him, comfort him, honour and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all other, keep only unto him as long as you both shall live? Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
I give this woman to this man.
Just at this moment, I just want to say a few words about covenant, because the God that we serve is a covenantal God. And through Jesus, we are in a covenantal relationship with him. Today, this is a covenant that's being made here today. And I've known these two for a few years, and I wouldn't marry anybody unless I believed that they were entering into this covenant, not entering into it lightly. And I know that these two have counted the cost, as it were. They've courted, they've bided the time, they've done it right. And so I'm pleased to be marrying them today, that I know that they're doing the right thing. Okay. I call upon these persons here present.
I call upon these persons here present.
To witness that I, Clinton Hutchinson.
To witness that I, Clinton Hutchinson.
Do take thee, Helen Louise Ward.
To be Louise Ward.
To be my lawful wedded wife.
To be my lawful wedded wife.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
To have and to hold from this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poorer.
For richer, for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish,
until death us do part,
according to God's holy ordinance,
and thereto I give you my promise. Hello, will you repeat after me, please?
I call upon these persons here present
to witness that I, Helen Louise Ward, do take thee, Clinton Hutchinson, to be my lawful wedded husband,
to have and to hold from this day forward,
for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, until death is due part, according to God's holy ordinance. And thereto I give you my promise. Okay, let me come to the rings. A ring can mean two different things. It can be a never-ending sign of love, or it can be a shackle. I'm going to charge you with a memory you should remember always. This woman stands by your side, not under your feet. You have the responsibility of being the head of this union. You have spiritual responsibility. I want you to give this ring in remembrance that she is your helpmate. It must never be a shackle of dominance, but always a reminder of faith and love. As you place the ring on her finger, please repeat. I give you this ring as the token of the covenant made between us this day and as a pledge of our mutual love. I want you to place this ring on his finger with these things in mind. There is no place in the Word of God that gives people the right to dominate one another. Your vows have stated that you submit to one another in the responsibilities of this life, expecting God and his power to always make the difference. So place this ring on his finger, and as you do, say this to him. I give you this ring as the token of the covenant made between us this day and as a pledge of our mutual love. For as much as Clinton Hutchinson and Helen Louise Ward have consented together in holy matrimony before God and in the presence of this company and have pledged faithfulness to each other by the giving and receiving of a ring and by joining hands, I now pronounce them husband and wife in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Those whom God has joined together, let no man put asunder. You may kiss the bride. Okay, at this point, if you'd like to take your seats, Juliet is going to come and do us a poem.
This poem is about the love between Jesus and his bride, and it's called One Sweet Kiss. One sweet kiss from my mouth would ignite the flickering flame of love's bright light. Arousing her passion and fanning her flame, she so delights at the sound of your name. Your name most worthy adorned with perfume, your sweet smelling scent enhancing her bloom. Beholding your beauty, she's drawn to your side. On the wings of your love, she beckons to ride. She calls out to you, inquiring your stay. Where do you rest at the noon of day? She follows your path trodden before, your echoing voice she can hardly ignore. Pondering your prints, she recites her new song. To you I long after, to you I belong. Responding her gesture, you disclose of your love. Thou art fair, my bride, in the eyes of the God. She is so overwhelmed and unable to contain but the news of your love and to her that you came. She sat under your shadow, capturing your shade, savouring your song which earlier you had made. To the banqueting house you willingly led, holding your love banner over her head. So taken with love, she fell from her feet, as you fed her with fruits, apples most sweet. Solomon's Song, chapter 6, verse 3. I am my beloved's and my beloved is mine.
Harry is going to come and sing for us and minister to us in song. Read to you from Luke 15, which is the parable the prodigal son, or the new translation, say the lost son. And just reading from verses 11 to 32, I shall read it to you, it says, "Then he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. So he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. Then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But then, when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet, and bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now his older son was in the field, and as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry and would not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him." I shall finish reading there. In verse 12, it says, "And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of the goods that falls to me. All that we have, whether we believe it or not, comes from God. I thank God for every day that I'm alive and that I'm breathing, and for the provision of God." And in verse 13, it says, "And not many days after the younger son gathered all together, he journeyed to a far country, and the son went his own way." And how many of us go our own way? You know, I think today's society, the main song is the Frank Sinatra song, "I Did It My Way." And so many of us, whether we've started on a journey with God, whether we've never come into a relationship with God, come to a point sometimes where we sing that song, "I'll do it my way." Then in verse 14, "Spent everything, there was a famine, he was in want, he was living away from his father," and in this context, living away from God. And then it says in verse 17, "But he came to himself." He came to himself. And what I want to concentrate on, just to leave you with today, is not the fact that when we do things our own way, we live outside of God's laws, or we do things that we know are wrong. God doesn't dwell upon the sin. I want to just express to you the Father's heart. God didn't and doesn't look at our wrongdoing and rebellion, whatever we have done. God's heart is revealed. He saw him a great way off and had compassion on him and ran to meet him and hugged and kissed him. He gave him his best robe, his sandals and jewelry and had a party. There was no condemnation. And I want us to understand something this afternoon, that is God's heart. It is not to condemn. Wherever we find ourselves, whatever situation we find ourselves in, God does not want to condemn us, but his heart is to bring us into a relationship with him, and he wants to run to us and hug us. And church, let let's not have the attitude of the elder son, that when he saw the other son returned, he was angry. Let us rejoice at everybody that comes into relationship with Jesus. Let us not be, if God is not a condemning God, then let us as a church not be condemning. And let us have that compassion and that heart that Jesus has towards everybody.
Amen.
I'm going to leave it there because I can't say enough.
Amen.
At this point, I should consult my manual. We're going to have the signing of the register and the musical interlude. Okay? Shall I juggle? Okay.
Holy, 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 holy
Ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to present to you Mr. and Mrs. Hutchinson.
And everything I lost. There's the lucky man. Oh, there he goes. Oh. What's it like being married? Does it? I know.
Simply let you know, Clinton.
No.
It's not going to work, so she's gone.
Well, that's where the bride should be. I think she's done one. Wednesday next. One day. I can see right over your nose. Now the groom's done one.
They are now one, and you and I, as a mother and father, serve her parents, and that will
will always be here to help them should they want it. many from me today. And so, for Leslie and the team, I'd like to say thank you very much, Sharon.
Just from the good corners there, he starts singing.